It's never too early to think about next school year. But how does Arkansas stack up in its education? Madison Hartley will teach you about the state's teachers.
And there's one word on everyone's mind, vaccines. So will the U of A require vaccinations this fall? What to expect to stay healthy on the Hill?
I spoke with the first openly trans elected official in Arkansas. What she says about this week's historic legislation and what the future holds for Arkansas. UATV starts right now.
Welcome to this Wednesday night broadcast of UATV. I'm Joshua Pineda.
And I'm Kaylin Jackson. Thanks for joining us. Yesterday, Governor Hutchinson's veto of House Bill 1570 was overturned by Arkansas State Senate and House of Representatives. This makes Arkansas the first state to ban gender affirmation surgeries and hormonal treatment of minors. UATV's J.C. Dodd joins us live with the story. J.C.?
That's right, Kaylin. State Representative Robin Ludstrom is the lead sponsor of House Bill 1570. She says the bill is meant to protect children from experimentation. And the bill passed in both the House and State Senate with an overwhelming majority.
This would be and is a vast government overreach.
Governor Hutchinson says minors seeking hormonal treatment and gender-confirming surgeries deserve a guiding hand from their parents and healthcare professionals. But House Bill 1570 would prevent just that. Opponents say the bill puts politicians in charge of a child's medical care instead of a medical professional. Yesterday, the ACLU issued a statement announcing it will be filing a lawsuit to challenge the law. The University of Arkansas's Director of Gender Studies, Dr. Lisa Corrigan, says the law isn't constitutional and that it is an intentionally destructive bill.
Access to life-saving, gender-affirming healthcare is a social right, and so we should be supporting trans youth.
I spoke with Evelyn Rios Stafford, who is the first openly trans woman ever elected to public office in Arkansas. Rios Stafford met with Governor Hutchinson last week about the damaging effects HB 1570 could have on Arkansas's transgender youth.
You know, I'm really heartbroken right now for a trans youth in our state and for their parents and their families who are, I know, going through a tough time right now, and I've heard from some of them personally. But my message is that you do have people in your corner and that are not going to stop fighting for you.
House Bill 1570 is just one of many bills targeting transgender people in this legislative session. I reached out to the lead sponsor of 1570, Representative Robin Ludstrom, and she was unavailable for comment. Kaylin?
JC, what does this bill mean for transgender youth who have already started gender affirming treatments?
Well, Kaylin, Rio Stafford says that is one of the most dangerous parts of this bill. Trans youth who have already begun gender affirming treatments will not be grandfathered in, and once the bill is law, they would have to stop treatment. Kaylin?
Thank you, JC. House Bill 1570 is set to become law later this summer.
The U of A reports 13 total active cases of COVID-19 on campus. The total includes 6 new cases in the reporting period of the past 2 days. 12 of the cases are students, with one being a staff member. Cases have not risen above 100 since last November. And the Arkansas Department of Health reports an additional 244 cases today. This brings the total number of active cases in the state to over 1,600. The number of deaths in the state also increased by 7, making the total number of deaths in Arkansas 5,660.
The Arkansas Department of Health also released the newest vaccination numbers today. Just over 27,000 doses were administered, making the total number of doses given in the state over 1.3 million. So far, over 492,000 Arkansans have been fully immunized. Across the country, schools such as Rutgers and Northeastern University require their students to get the COVID vaccine. This caused some uncertainty as to whether universities should require their students to get vaccinated. The U of A plans to host full in-person classes next fall semester, dependent on COVID cases at the university. Pat Walker Health Center Communication Director Zach Brown says as for now, the university will not require vaccinations.
At this time, you know, we can confidently say that we are not going to require the COVID-19 vaccine for students, faculty, or staff as part of a, you know, face-to-face requirement.
Brown urges the U of A community to get their vaccination as vaccine eligibility continues to open to all students.
The ongoing pandemic led to many major adjustments, and schools were no exception. UATV's Madison Hartley is live with the story. Madison.
Right, and one of those adjustments deals with staffing, or lack thereof.
Teaching shortages across the country were an issue before the pandemic, but the majorly impactful COVID-19 certainly didn't help the situation. Both students and teachers have had to adapt to different methods.
The pandemic has really caused extra stress on teachers to the point where I feel like we've got so many that are not wanting to come back because they have so much responsibility at home and then again at school with the extra work due to all the technology, and it's caused a lot of teachers to want to take a leave of absence.
When schools can't find enough qualified teachers, they usually resort to asking the state for waivers to hire people who haven't met state requirements for certification. Research done by the New Teacher Project, also known as TNTP, found that Arkansas's average of uncertified teachers is more than double the national average, sitting at 4% compared to 1.7%. TNTP gave three main reasons for the shortages, naming compensation challenges, a lack of incentives, and that the rural districts, who have the highest shortages, don't have enough teacher-qualified citizens.
And the teachers that are certified did that and chose that profession because they want to work one-on-one or they want to work with children directly, either one-on-one or in groups, and not have to deal with so much of the technology issues.
And though teaching shortages have been a decade-long issue, vaccinations and more COVID combat progress gives schools hope.
It is going to help us find more qualified people for these positions in the future.
Now, the report showed most Northwest Arkansas districts in pretty good shape with only a 0 to 2% estimate of uncertified teachers. For UATV, I'm Madison Hartley.
Thanks, Madison. For the full report, you can go to the Special Projects page of the Walton Family Foundation website.
Take a look. It's in a book.
This reading is actually really fun.
What one organization is doing to help the Razorbacks read.
And how you can give back to all your favorite local nonprofits all in one spot tomorrow. I'll have more after the break.
Tomorrow, NWA Gives will host its fourth annual Day of Giving event. UATV's Lexi French is live to tell us how to get involved and support local nonprofits. Lexi?
NWA Gives encourages the community to get involved in the event by visiting their website tomorrow to view the nearly 300 local nonprofits that you can donate to.
Members of nonprofits came together Tuesday to prepare for and celebrate the upcoming Day of Giving. The annual online event allows local nonprofits to fundraise and grow connections within the Northwest Arkansas community.
So every April, we invite nonprofits to rally together, come together to invite people to give to those nonprofits. You know, the mission is to really help meet needs in Northwest Arkansas.
Along with hosting the online event, NWA Gives also provides marketing and fundraising training for nonprofits throughout the year.
Is that this year we'll see an even greater just flow of generosity, of resources that really do a lot to help give nonprofits what they need to be able to meet needs in our community. You know, and our vision is to help create one of the most generous communities in America. There's amazing nonprofits on there. I mean, I think if you'll go to the list and see who's there, you'll find somewhere that really connects with your heart of giving.
The Day of Giving will take place Thursday through the NWA Gives website.
The annual Day of Giving begins at 8 a.m. on Thursday. And to get involved, you can simply visit the NWA Gives website, where you can make a donation or learn more about the nonprofits that are registered this year.
The Day of Giving allows the community to support causes that impact Northwest Arkansas.
This year, more nonprofits joined the event than previous years. So there will definitely be plenty of different nonprofit options to pick from tomorrow. Reporting live for UATV, I'm Lexi French.
Thanks, Lexi. The Day of Giving event will start at 8 in the morning and continue until 8 tomorrow evening.
One national organization makes a new home on the Hill. Reading is Fundamental is a nationwide group focused on promoting early childhood literacy. The U of A chapter of RIF began operations earlier this semester and is the first collegiate branch. The RSO was founded by one student who had previously worked with the organization.
So I reached out to them and just basically asked, like, can we bring a chapter here to the U of A? Because I am pretty involved on campus, so that was the first way I thought I could do it, was like, I know how to make a chapter.
The group is currently hosting a book drive collecting books for kids grades K through 4. Book collection bins can be found across campus in locations like Mullins Library and the Arkansas Union.
Whistle while you work. Woodwork, that is.
And it just turned into such an encouraging place.
We'll share the story of how one organization built itself a brand.
And speaking of building, Crystal Bridges has a big new project coming its way. We'll tell you what to expect and when you can visit coming up.
Crystal Bridges Art Museum announced a massive expansion this morning. The project will add 100,000 square feet to the facility, expanding its space by 50%. Developers are currently working on designing the expansion, with construction slated to begin next year and completed in 2024.
As some small businesses struggle to recover from lost time during the pandemic, some Facebook groups offer a helping hand. UATV's Reagan Holland has a story.
With a passion for art and community, Bo Dutton started two Facebook pages, NWA Makers Club, which is private and only for makers, and NWA Makers Gallery, which is public for everyone to view.
I knew there were like-minded people out there in the same exact position as me, so I started this group so we could kind of just connect and say, hey, I'm here if you need help.
In addition to connecting members with tools and supplies, NWA Makers Club offers artists a place to freely discuss the back end of their business.
It's kind of fun for us to have a curtain up and be able to talk about the cost of materials and the process and that kind of stuff without everybody being able to kind of see what we've got going on.
Owner of Second Lifewood and Ozark Lawn and Landscape, Dylan Taylor says he's found Dutton's Facebook group to be helpful in staying connected with fellow makers during the pandemic.
As you age, you become less social, or at least I have. And so this was a great way for me to really, you know, just see who is out there and what they're making.
Taylor says he finds himself motivated most when watching Dutton's Facebook community grow so quickly.
It really inspires you to persevere and keep doing what you're doing and just know that you're not alone out there trying to hustle and make a dream a reality.
Dutton says he believes the community aspect his Facebook group brings to makers is what resonates most.
And it's just turned into such an encouraging place where anytime anybody posts anything, 10 people are jumping in saying, hey man, this is awesome. How'd you do that? What'd you finish that with? That kind of thing.
Starting just 3 months ago, NWA Makers Club has almost 800 members, offering makers quite the online community.
Dutton says he hopes his Facebook group serve as an inviting community for both makers, hobbyists, and those looking to buy something unique.
One Razorback team breaks two program records.
And the Diamondhawks square off against an in-state rival. See how they're faring next on UATV Sports.
Welcome back to UATV Sports. I'm Ben Sawyers here with your Wednesday night sports update. Hitting it off with baseball, the Razorbacks took down the Little Rock Trojans last night at Baumarker Stadium 7-2. Hot-handed pitching from Cole Ramage and Ryan Cossiou led the Hogs defense, holding the Trojans offense to 2 runs. Robert Moore, Caden Wallace, and Christian Franklin led the offense, totaling 6 RBIs on the game. It's been a stellar stretch for Wallace, who has batted 442 in the last 11 games. The Omaha Hogs started their second home game against the Trojans earlier this evening, and the final score of that game was 10-3, with the Hogs securing the win. And the Razorback softball team comes off a commanding 9-1 win over the Missouri State Bears. The Hogs hit a record 6 home runs to break the program's single-game record. SEC Player of the Week Braxton Burnside launched a solo home run in the fourth, adding to five long balls hit in the fourth and fifth innings. The Hogs are second in the home run standings nationally with 69 on the season, shattering the program's regular season home run record. Autumn Storms led the defensive effort with a stellar night of pitching, only allowing one run and racking up seven strikeouts. Arkansas welcomes the number three Alabama Crimson Tide to Bogle Park this weekend for a three-game home stretch. The first game of that series starts this Friday, April 9th at 6 p.m. Coming off an Elite Eight appearance, the Razorback men's basketball team is looking to reframe the roster. Earlier today, head coach Eric Musselman announced that the University of Miami transfer Chris Likes signed with Arkansas. Musselman said, quote, "Chris is a proven, dynamic guard who has excelled in the ACC. He has the ability to score and get his teammates involved," end quote. Likes played only two games last season before an ankle injury left the season's senior sideline for the season. The 5'7 guard has been prolific in the past, averaging 15.4 points per game in his last full season with the Cyclones. And fans can attend Razorback Outdoor Track and Field Meets this season. Arkansas is set to host two meets this season with the John McDonnell Invitational April 23rd and 24th and Arkansas Twilight on May 7th. Tickets for both meets went on sale this morning. All adult tickets were $5, and all fans under 17 will receive free admission. Masks and social distancing will be required for both events. And the football team will host fans Saturday, April 17th at 2 p.m. in the spring game. The spring game divides the roster in two for a head-to-head team matchup. Fans can attend for free but must claim tickets online in advance. Seating will be socially distanced and masks will be required. And the women's golf team ended their campaign in Baton Rouge at the LSU Tiger Golf Classic. The team placed fifth in the tournament while redshirt junior Brooke Matthews walked away with a second-place trophy after shooting two under par. That's all for UATV Sports. We'll be back with more after the break.
After some scattered showers today, sunshine is back tomorrow with slightly warmer temperatures.
The high tomorrow will be 72 with lows in the 50s overnight.
And as we head into the weekend, there is 60% chance of rain on Friday.
Whether you are a fan of a pale ale or prefer a strong stout, you might want to celebrate National Beer Day today.
There are several local breweries here. You can enjoy a beverage of your choice.
If you are ambitious, you can attempt the Fayetteville Ale Trail, a self-guided beer tour around Northwest Arkansas.
That's all the time we have. I'm Kaylin Jackson.
And I'm Joshua Pineda. Good night.